He says, now griha karma kal. Sometimes we feel that karma is responsible for my suffering. All the impious activities that I have done in the past, these impious activities that I have done in the past are bearing fruit today. And because the impious activities of the past are bearing fruit today, therefore I am studying. I am suffering. In fact, there was one, yesterday I met one lady who was saying, my mother, she always says that when sufferings come upon her, she says, ye toh mere pichle janam ke karma honge. That's why I am suffering. So she blames the karma that she has done in the past for the present suffering. But he says, no, not even your karma is responsible for your suffering. And neither kal. Sometimes we say that it is eternal time that is responsible for all our miseries, because time takes everything away. It takes away family, friends, relations. It takes away money, it takes away your job, it takes away eventually your own life. So sometimes people blame kal. So he says, not even kal, not even time is responsible for my suffering. So nayam jano me sukha dukha etur na devata atma griha karma kal. Never blame all these people for your miseries. It's not people who are torturing you. Neither the demigods, nor your body, nor your bad stars, nor your past karma, not even eternal time itself. Then what is responsible for the suffering? This was identified by the Brahmin of Avanti. And because he was able to identify the main cause of his suffering, he was able to tolerate the miseries. And what did he identify as the cause of his sufferings? He said very clearly, he said, Mana param karanam amananti sansara chakram parivartayedyat. It is my mind and my mind only which is the cause of all my sufferings. It's my mind and it's my mind only which is the cause of all my sufferings. And he says, and it is my mind that drags me again and again into the cycle of birth and death. So the cause of the miseries is not other people. The cause of miseries is not your body, not the demigod, not your bad stars, not your previous karma, not even eternal time. The cause of all your sufferings in this world is none other than your own mind. It is your mind that is your greatest enemy, and it is your mind that is the cause of your suffering. Sometimes people say that, no, I don't agree, it's my mind. These things are actually real, these things are actually troubling me. I have got a diseased body. I am going through my Sadhya-Satri period. I have offended the demigod. I have performed bad karma for which I am suffering today. But these are only external manifestations of suffering. The actual suffering takes place inside here. The actual suffering takes place inside here. It takes place because of your mind. For one who has controlled his mind, there is no suffering. Therefore it has been said that the mind is your greatest enemy, your mind is your greatest friend. For one who has controlled his mind, the mind is the greatest friend. But for one who has not controlled his mind, the mind is the greatest enemy. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Bandhur Atmana Atmanastasya, Yena Atmayava Atmana Jita, Anatmanastu Shatrutve, Vartet Atmayava Tu Shatruva. That the mind can be your greatest friend or your greatest enemy. For one who's controlled the mind is the greatest friend. For one who has not controlled the mind is the greatest enemy. And the mind is the cause of all suffering. You see people who are going through unimaginable difficulties, but they are unshaken by them because they have controlled their mind. That is the definition of a person who has controlled his mind. So once again, it is the mind which is your greatest enemy, it is the mind which is the cause of sufferings, and finally it is your mind which makes you fall down from spiritual life and re-enter into material life. Actually, you cannot get rid of your mind. Your mind is your constant companion. Where you go, your mind will go with you. I remember one boy came to me and told me, he says, I am absolutely disgusted now with what I am doing here in India. I've got serious plans to emigrate to America, and once I go to America, I'll be happy. So I told him that, look, you're still young. You may go to America, but if you go to America, you're taking your greatest enemy along with you. Your mind is going to accompany you right from here to America. And the cause of your misery is not your external circumstances. The cause of your misery is your mind. And if you are not able to control your mind, then you will be taking your misery on your back along with you. I remember we used to have the stories of Sinbad the sailor. So in Sinbad the sailor, there is an example of Sinbad the sailor who is marooned on a desert island. And when he goes on a desert island, what does he find? He finds an old, hunchbacked, wretched looking man sitting on the dwarf, sitting on the beach. And that hunchbacked dwarf, old man, he looks at him and says that I am crippled and hunchbacked, please carry me. Because if you carry me, I'll be able to get up from this beach and go to some place more comfortable. So Sinbad, being very kind to him, takes him on his back. But once that old man is on his back, he has great distress. Because that old man is the old man of the sea. And he has no intention of getting off from Sinbad's back. Not only he sits on his back, but he locks his ankles behind Sinbad's shoulder blades and holds on to Sinbad's hair and ear. And he makes him go here and there and here and there, and he bites him and kicks him and he boxes him until Sinbad does exactly what he wants. So our mind is like the old man of the sea on Sinbad the sailor's back. Try as you may, you cannot get rid of him. And that mind will accompany you and it will force you to do what exactly what it wants to do. You know that it is bad. You know that you shouldn't do it. You know that you should be doing something else. But your mind will drag you and force you and pinch you and box you and pull your hair and pull your ear and force you to do exactly what you should not do. And try as you might, there is no way that you can take the mind off your back. Because the mind is the most difficult thing to control. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is talking to Arjuna and Arjuna tells him. He says, Chanchalahi mana Krishna pramati balava dridam tasyaham nigram manye vayu riva saduskaram. He says, my mind is restless, it is turbulent, it is obstinate. Restless, turbulent and obstinate, and to try to control my mind is like trying to control the wind. To try to control the mind is like trying to control the wind. So it is impossible to try to control the mind or get rid of it, because the mind will harass you and force you to do exactly what you should not do. And the characteristics of the mind are such that it will completely fool you into thinking that you are doing the right thing. Because the mind can convince you exactly what it wants to convince you. It will make you believe that what you are doing is the right thing. It will give you hundreds of arguments and thousands of arguments and millions of arguments why what you are doing is the best thing under the right circumstances. And no matter how you try to approach the mind will try to escape from your efforts to control it. It's like trying to kill a cockroach. Anyone here tried to kill a cockroach? Even if you corner a cockroach in the corner of the room and you approach it with a slipper to bang the cockroach to death, suddenly the cockroach will flatten itself and get into a crevice and will be out of your reach. So the mind is like that. At least cockroach you can see, the mind you can't see. Sometimes you think you are the mind. So how can you actually control the mind or kill it? Because it is absolutely impossible to try to control it by normal means. It will escape, it will wriggle, it will squeeze, it will rationalize. It will argue and explain to you. And it will convince you that what you are doing is the right thing. This is the nature of the mind. And the qualities of the mind are such that it has got three main defects. What are the three main defects of the mind? One is, its first defect is it has got mala. That means it has got impurities. What are these impurities? These impurities are the past impressions that are already inflicted and present in the mind. Lust, anger, greed, envy, illusion, madness. These are all the mala, all the impurities that are there in the mind. And these impurities are remaining in the mind waiting to manifest themselves. And every activity which you do, which is motivated by lust, anger, greed, envy, illusion, madness, that is stored in the mind as mal. I remember my friend in medical college, he was telling me, he says, look, don't give me lectures about avoiding illicit sex and waiting until I get married. He said, see, I made up my mind that until I get married, I will have as much fun with as many women and girls as I like. But once I get married, I'll be very faithful to my wife. So I said, do you realize what you're doing? He said, what do you think I'm doing? I told you this is what I'll do. I said, just try to understand one thing. You have underestimated the capacity of your mind. Every action you do, which is actually motivated by lust, anger, greed, envy, illusion, is imprinted in your mind. You think that when you are with your wife, you will be alone. You are not going to be alone with your wife. When you are with your wife, all your former girlfriends will also be sitting around you. Why? Because you'll be carrying them with you in your mind. And this is a fact. I told him, you do what you want and you tell me after you get married whether what I said is correct or not. And you will notice that you are never alone with a woman that you have married, because you are carrying with you that mull, that impurities. And those impurities in the form of those women will accompany you wherever you are. You are carrying them as your baggage on your back. These mental impressions are permanently installed in your brain now. So this is the mull that everybody carries around. Then we have vikshep. The mind is always tossing. It's always restless. It can never sit in one place. It is impossible for the mind to sit in one place. In fact, the mind has been compared to a street dog. Have you seen a street dog anywhere? Dog never sits in one place. It's always looking for some interesting smell, and it will go to one place, find something interesting. After some time, it will get bored. Again, it's always roaming from one place to the other. It can never be sitting in one place. Therefore, it goes from one place to another place to another. And what happens to the street dog? It gets kicked. It goes to one place. When it gets a kick, then it leaves and goes to the next place. That is the nature of the mind. The mind will pursue one train of thoughts until it gets one kick. Then when you get a kick, mental kick, and you realize that, oh, I was not doing the right thing, then you will still go in another direction. And so this is the nature of the mind. Like a street dog, it will go sniffing in all the dirtiest places until it is forcibly kicked and thrown out. In fact, the mind is also compared to the monkey. The monkey cannot sit still on one tree. It's always swinging from branch to branch. It's always swinging from one place to the other. This is the nature of the mind. It is always restless and it is always turbulent. It can never sit still in one place. And don't think that you can actually try to control this restlessness. Have you ever seen mercury? Mercury in a thermometer? Try to take mercury in a thermometer and close your fist over it. The mercury will slip out from between your fingers. And when it falls, each one drop of mercury will become hundreds of drops of mercury. Hundreds, literally hundreds, you will see shiny globules of mercury on the floor. So also the mind has a tendency that it can never be gripped, because it always slips out of your grasp. Not only it slips out of your grasp, but it goes in 1 million directions. It goes in 1 million directions. And lastly, the mind contains within it the ability of avarana. That is, it covers over. How does it cover over? The ability of the mind is that it covers you over with the illusion. What illusion does it cover you over with? The illusion of permanency. This is the illusion in the world. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that na sato vidyate bhavo na bhavo vidyate sato ubayor api drishtvantastva anyos tattva darshibi. That of what is unreal, there is no continuation, and of that which is real, there is no cessation. This is what learned seers have concluded. That if something is unreal, then it will not last. But if something is real, it will be permanent. But in the world we see around us, what is permanent? Nothing is permanent in the world. Nothing is permanent. Can you name anything just now which you see with your eyes, hear with your ears, smell with your nose, taste with your tongue, touch with your skin that is permanent? Nothing that you can put.